sorrow I was silent. For so long I did not have a song to praise.
Good morning, everyone.
Christ filled my day.
It's kind of dark.
And clouds blocked my way. But there was a voice speaking to me, awaking the passion.
Good morning, Sister Tangie. Good morning, Grandmaster 71.
So still in me.
Good morning, Ashley Charisse. Good morning. Good morning, Ella Miller 19. Good morning, Miss Gilmore.
Morale.
Good morning, Deacon Josh.
I can't lay here
and
give up, no.
Oh, that wasn't Deacon Josh.
Oh, that's Josh. Are y'all in Warner Robins or Valdosta? Good morning.
Good morning
from the class. Good morning.
Tracy O'Kane, good morning. Welcome to Abundant Life this morning. Scott 406. Allison, good morning. Good morning, Susan.
Is that your voice?
Why are you shaking your head?
Into that sea.
Good morning, Morale.
With thee. My heart is long for this moment with thee. I choose to worship. Do I have anybody in here tonight that chooses to worship?
The wrong, I know it, I know. Good morning, Yolanda, please. Good morning, Pastor Percy.
Well, good morning. Happy second Sunday of 2016, January the 10th.
Good morning, Bernard and LaBrenda.
Good morning. We're going to open in prayer.
I'm trying to make sure we got some good light here so we can see him.
Okay. Amen.
Can everybody see him okay? Good morning, Mr. Music.
Good morning.
Okay.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We bless you. We honor you for this day. For God, this is the day that you've made, and we're rejoicing and we're glad in it. Father, we thank you for
good
all
morning,
that you're
Dallas
doing
family.
In our lives. Thank you, God, that individually you're showing yourself powerful. And because you're doing it individually,
good morning,
corporately,
Felicia.
You're allowing your power to be revealed in our lives. And Father, today we take just a few moments to invite your presence into our home. Invite your presence, God, into every person's life that is logged in from all over the world via Periscope and or conference call, Father. Father, I ask now that you meet
Hello,
every
Mr.
need.
Lord.
God, I pray right now that you answer every question. Father, right now, I pray right now that your real anointing continues to remove burdens and to destroy yokes like we've never seen it before. But Father, we anticipate today you're going to send a word that would transition us into fulfilling our divine assignment that you've commissioned us to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. First Lady, if you would join me.
Yes, sir. Good Amen. Morning, everyone.
Well, I want to take this opportunity to welcome you to Abundant Life Ministries, where we are just real people with real issues looking
for real answers.
For real answers. And we're excited as we are in a transitional phase right now. And God has allowed us to acquire our own building, and
yes,
we're just so excited about all that he's doing. Due to some governmental inspections, we were delayed by 1 week. However, next Sunday, we step foot into our promised place, and we're looking for God to continue to launch us into 2016 like we've never experienced it. Yes. So with that, 3940 Buford Highway, Suite B110, Duluth, Georgia, 30096, next Sunday, January the 17th at 10:30 a.m. You better be there or be square, because we are believing God for something amazing as we approach phase one of our build out. So on behalf of myself and my better half, my lovely wife, we want to say thank you for tuning in from all over the world via Periscope and or conference call. And we believe that there's a word for you on today. So now, First Lady is going to give us our morning announcements, and we're going to go right into the word.
Good morning again, everyone. First of all, I want to talk about Periscope and how Periscope work, and because it's really been beneficial for us. We've been gaining a lot of followers, and people have been really enjoying the message through Periscope. So with the hearts, all you have to do is tap your screen in order to give hearts. And hearts is just a way of showing love or showing us that you're enjoying the message. You can comment, you can say amen, you can say hallelujah, you can repeat back what Pastor has said, maybe because someone could have missed it, and what you put on there can also allow someone else to get what they might have missed. So give us some love today. Give us some love when you log on Periscope, and give us some hearts. And as far as sharing your broadcast, you'll be sharing to your Twitter followers and I think to your contacts. And the way you share is with your iPhone, you're going to swipe to the right. And with Android, you're going to swipe up and then tap share. With your iPhone, you're going to swipe to the right, and with Android, you're going to swipe up and then tap share. And you will be able to share the message with all of your followers. If you all are enjoying this word that Pastor has given us and what he's teaching us, others want to enjoy it as well and get to hear the truth that he has been preaching from the Word of God. So we appreciate all of you all logging on and just hanging in there with us through our transition, and just really being faithful to God for your ministry. So we appreciate that. And just for a couple announcements. We're going to continue on with our Friday morning prayer at 8:30 a.m. every Friday morning. I have definitely been enjoying them, and I know that you are too. Thursday night, January 14th, we are going to have our ministerial call. And that will be with Bishop this Thursday evening, January 14th at 8:30 p.m. And January 22nd, we are still going to continue going forward with our Women's Bible Study Boot Camp. That is going to be at our new location. We will not be fully up yet, but we will be still meeting there. Yay! All the women. Yay! Yes, we're excited about that. All the women will still be meeting there. Bring your Bibles, bring your girl talk,
yes,
bring
she does
your
look great.
Love for the Lord, and let's just get together and just enjoy one another's company. Next month, February, if you all remember last year, February, we had our Fight for Your Family Month. And as you know, Abundant Life is a ministry that absolutely loves family. We love marriage, we love love. And we want to do everything to help every single couple fight for their marriage, fight for their family. So we're going to start the series on Fight for Your Family next month. Pastor and I will be teaching you all on how to stay married, how to be happily married, and how to continue to love one another. And next month, we will also be planning a couples night or a special couples event. So get ready for all the exciting things we have going on. Thank you all for your time, and I'm going to hand it back over to my wonderful husband.
Amen, amen. If you would govern yourselves accordingly, just to piggyback on what First Lady said concerning the series. Last year, it was so impactful that we dare not mirror or reflect that same impact this year. And last year it was in seed form, so I'm excited to see. I've watched the families grow and evolve and mature even within the last 12 months. So I believe the information that the Lord will continue to share with us is going to cause families to become stronger. Because contrary to popular belief, in order to have a strong church, you must first have a strong family. And in order to have a strong family, you must have strong relationships. So with that being said, I know last week I started a series of how to have a more intimate relationship with God.
Yes.
And we begin to uncover that we are supposed to put first things first. And our theme scripture came out of Matthew 6, to seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness.
Yes, we'll be on Periscope
and
as
all
well.
The other things that shall be added unto you. I had intentions on continuing that series today, but the Holy Ghost kind of interrupted my program.
My God.
So I want to be obedient to him, but it is my undesirable approach next week to make sure that we pin back up on that series. So the first Sunday in the building, we'll be looking to pick back up on the series of how to have a more intimate relationship with God. But with that being said, we're going to go right to the Word of God.
Good morning, Prophet.
Exodus chapter number 4. Exodus chapter number 4. We're going to begin reading at verse number 1. Exodus chapter number 4, verse number 1. And the word of the Lord declares, and
Maria.
Moses answered and said, behold, they will not believe me nor hearken unto my voice. For they will say, the Lord hath not appeared unto thee. And the Lord said unto him, what is that in thine hand? And he said, a rod. And he said, cast it on the ground. He cast it on the ground and it became a serpent. And Moses fled from before it. And the Lord said unto Moses, put forth thy hand and take it by the tail. And he put forth his hand and caught it, and it became a rod in his hand, that they may believe that the Lord God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob hath appeared unto thee. And the Lord said furthermore unto him, put now thine hand into thy bosom. And he put his hand into his bosom. And when he took it out, behold, his hand was leprous as snow. And he said, put thine hand into thy bosom again. And he put his hand into his bosom again and plucked it out of his bosom. And behold, it was turned again as his other flesh. And it come to pass, if they would not believe thee, neither hearken to the voice of the first sign, that they will believe the voice of the latter sign. Today I want to speak to you from the subject in the form of a question. Brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, Protestants and or Christians, what is that in thine hand? What is that in thine hand? This is a very, very familiar scripture. It's an ongoing chronological story concerning the children of Israel. And I've ministered from this particular text before about the children of Israel. But for some of you all that may not be aware, the children of Israel started with a man by the name of Abram. And the Lord spoke to him back in Genesis, and God decided that if he was going to select a group of people, place a mark upon them, and literally extract them out of the world system, and he was going to allow his glory to be revealed through them. This we know now as the children of Israel. However, it started with just a man by the name of Abram. And in your Bible time, if you read through Genesis 12, you'll start to hear all the great things that God said concerning Abram. He said, I'm going to make your name great. I'm going to bless them that bless you. I'm going to curse them that curse you. And I'm going to cause all the families of the earth to be blessed through you. But he said, on your way there, you're going to go to a strange land. You're going to dwell there 400 years and 400 years of bondage. But in that, the children of Israel begin to pray and they begin to cry out and they begin to say, well, if we are the chosen people, if we are really chosen by God, how in the world are we in a place of being bound? Have you ever felt like you was in a place that looked so far and so different and looked like the complete opposite of what God has said concerning you? Well, that's what the children of Israel were. They were in a place now of being bound and being in a place where they had restrictions and somebody was telling them what to do. But God, after a period of time, he said, I have heard the cry and seen the afflictions of my people, and I've come down to deliver him. Now, I need you to understand something, Periscope Land. God doesn't send deliverance without a deliverer.
Amen.
Moses is the first indication that when he was ready to deliver the children of Israel out of Egypt, it started with a man by the name of Moses. But when he was ready to deliver the children of Israel out of the wilderness and take them into the promised land, it was also a man by the name of Joshua. When he was ready to deliver mankind from the sinful nature of the enemy, and he was ready to place them in their righteous place with God, he sent a man by the name of Jesus. See, God starts out the way that he finishes it. He gave authority over to man in the name of Adam, which is the reason when it came to the redemption process, the Bible didn't call him the second Adam, but he called him the last Adam. That means you only have one of two categories that you're going to be able to operate under. If you're operating under Adam, you're operating under the old covenant. If you're operating under Adam, you're operating under the law. And contrary to popular belief, if you're operating under Adam, you're operating against the grace of God. It is important that you understand that you cannot have an Adamic nature and walk in your flesh, but you can align yourself with what Jesus has said concerning you. Jesus is the way, and Jesus is the truth, and Jesus is the life. Now, Jesus is the deliverer when it comes to taking us out of the penalty of sin and placing us in this place of righteousness. But here, the children of Israel, God has heard their prayer. And he said, I've come down to deliver them. And he said, I found the person that I want to use. Now, I don't know about you, but there's been some tasks that's been put before me. Most recently in my life that I felt like I was not qualified for. It's no way that God can use me because I have all the excuses why I can't. But see, what I love about God and the Holy Ghost is he won't allow you to operate on your excuses why you can't. He'll just start giving you reasons why you can. Mm-hmm. See, the reason why you can is you can do all things through Christ that strengthens you. See, the reason why you can is he who the Son sets free is free indeed. The reason why you can is, lo, he'll be with you always, even unto the end of the world. So now God has said, I'm going down and I'm coming to get my children. Now, the first thing I need you all to understand today is God has heard your cry. God has sent your affliction, and he is sending deliverance right to your house. He sent deliverance right to your car, right to your office, wherever you may be. All you are just one word away from being snatched up out of that thing that you think have identified you call bondage. The children of Israel were there for 400 years. And then could you only imagine that their identity at that point was directly connected to their experiences? I don't know who you are, but see, if you're not careful, you will allow your experiences to become your identity. You will allow your garment, what you put on, to become the thing that you allow other people to identify you as. But see, What I love about God is God wants to change identities with you. God wants to change garments with you. God wants to exchange with you. So when he does that, he's going to send a deliverer. Now, I stand flat-footed to let you know that I don't claim to be Moses in your life, but I do claim to have a word from the Lord on today. And I tell you, if you grab hold to the word, the word would allow you to do something that you've never been able to experience before. See, a conference won't do nothing if you don't have a word. A prayer call won't do nothing if you don't have a word. See, Peter understood that when he was on the boat with all the other church folk and all the other religious folk and all the other people that was talking about that looked like Jesus. See, there's so many people around us in our boat. There's so many people around us in our circles, and they all talk a good game. They all make it seem like they got it going on. But the truth of the matter is they don't have a real word from God, because if they had a real word from God, the word comes to equip you. The word comes to activate your faith. The word comes to make you bust a move when everybody else is standing still, because Peter was on the boat just like everybody else. But the word that he heard caused something to activate on the inside of him and put him in a position where now, instead of just hanging out with folks, I'm gonna step out and do something different. If I was in service this morning, I would tell you to lean on your neighbor and tell them it's time to do something different. The same thing is going to get me the same result. That's the reason why we started out the year saying different choices, different results. You make better decisions, darling, you're going to get a better result. If you keep making the same 2014 choices, 2015, 16, 17, and 18 are all going to look the same. But see, what I love about God is God won't allow you to give him excuses. Moses starts saying, well, how will they know that I've come through you? How will they know that I've really been sent by you? So God literally starts to have a dialogue with them. And it opens up the text because verse number 2 says, and the Lord said unto him, what is that in thine hand? And he said, a rod. The first thing I want to ask you today is, what is that in your hand? What is it that God has given you from an ability point of view that's designed to make sure that you hit the target, to design and to assure that you do exactly what God has destined you to do in the earth? Listen, I don't know about you, but I don't want to be one of those people that go to the grave and I don't fulfill purpose. I made it up in my mind that I'm not just going to be an ordinary person running around talking about extraordinary stuff. If I'm supposed to do what God said I'm supposed to do, then I'm going to align myself and start doing it. I'm going to surround myself with people that's already doing it. I don't know about you, but listen, if you are having relationship challenges, get away from folks that's having the same relationship challenges. If you broke, stop hanging around folks that's always and giving you excuses on why you should remain where you are. You need to hang around with somebody that's going to stretch you. I wish I had time to preach this thing like I feel it. But you know, when you hang out with the right folk, when they start to pull and they start to stretch you and they start to make you feel uncomfortable, that's why you have a personal trainer. A trainer is there when you think you can only do 3 reps. They say, no, 4 more. Because they understand the last 4 is where the muscle is grown. The last 4 is where the strength is there. The last 4 is where the change and the transition is. See, I'm not here to just encourage you and make you feel better about your situation. I'm here to ask you today, what is that in thine hand? Well, Moses now started giving God excuses. And God just started to run down a resume. He said, what is that in your hand, Moses?
Come on.
Moses said, a rod. God says, cast it on the ground. And he cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent. And Moses fled from before it. See, it's amazing how God has equipped you to do some things that will scare you at times. It's amazing how sometimes God can anoint you to do something, but it's so much bigger than, it's so much greater than the capacity of your mind that it even scares you. You'll start thinking it's the devil. But God again told Moses, and the Lord said, and take it by the tail And he put forth his hand and caught it, and it became a rod in his hand. Mm. The same rod that had become a serpent. He said, no, I didn't give you the spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind. He said, now I need to take your hand and grab that tail. And when he grabbed the tail, it turned into a rod again. See, God is not trying to use you outside of the extension and the ability that he's given you. See, the problem with a lot of us is we're trying to use somebody else's stuff. And God is saying, I didn't give that to you. I didn't tell you to do that. You became passionate about something that I never instructed you to do. See, I gave this testimony some time ago, but as a young boy, I was very passionate about football. I really, really liked it. I mean, I liked it so much that even with my 70-pound little bitty self, thought I could play. And you know what? As long as I was watching it on TV, I thought I had it figured out. You know, I could be a wide receiver, and I learned how to go 10 out and cut left. And, you know, I had pretty good hands. But see, my hands is not what qualified me to be a good football player. I just wasn't big enough. So my passion took me to a place where I start trying out, and I even made the team. See, sometimes your passion can take you places that your body and your character cannot keep you. Because I ended up playing football, and in playing football, the very first play of practice, I caught a pass, but I got knocked out. Now, I need you to understand that I did catch the ball, so I had some ability, but God had not equipped me to walk the process out. So I took my behind somewhere, and I went and found me a horn, and now I'm known as the recording of saxophonist because I had to realize what was in my hand. See, some of us are trying to pick up a microphone, and God said, you need a pen. Jesus. Some of us need to have a microphone and you trying to do a pen. See, I realize I'm not anointed to write, which is why some of my stuff be messed up even on Facebook. But see, what I know about God is when you realize what he's anointed you to do, then burdens will be removed and yokes will be destroyed. But just because you're passionate about something does not mean God has equipped you to do it. Well, now God is dialoguing with Moses, and he start telling him to do some stuff with the stuff that he gave him. He said, I need you to be equipped. I need you to understand that what I trusted you with, it's enough. That's right. I need that to settle right there. What he's trusted you with, it's enough. Because then he starts saying, and he said, put thy hand into thy bosom. And he put it in his bosom. And plucked out his bosom. And he turned it again as it was flesh. So he started having him do stuff with the thing that he had trusted him with to prove to him that it worked. See, one of the ways you need to know that God has trusted you to do something is when you're able to look back over your life and the times that something should have killed you, it allowed you to make it through. It allowed you to be sustained. It allowed you to be put in a position where other people were destroyed, committed suicide, and lost their mind, you still was able to maintain. But see, what I love about God is God doesn't change his mind just because you change your choices. God doesn't change his mind just because you change relationships. God doesn't change his mind just because you change churches. God don't change his mind just because you change jobs. If he said what's in your hand the first time, he's going to hold fast to it. Yeah. If he said what's in your hand the first time, he will continue to remind you. See, I need you to understand something. The trick of the enemy is to try to uproot a godly seed, to uproot a godly purpose, to uproot what God has intended for you to do. But see, what I love about God is even when the thief comes in to steal, kill, and to destroy, God's still going to give life, and he's going to give it more abundantly. Yes. Because Moses now has finally put himself in a position. He said, well, I'm going to obey. But if you read further in your scripture reading of the same chapter, then he started dialoguing again with God. He said, okay, I got something in my hand. But God, I can't talk. God, I got a stutter. God, I don't have eloquency of speech. I don't know who I'm talking to. But see, some of us have tried to allow our stutter to be the reason why God cannot use you. God said, I made your tongue. I made you that way, and I know what hinders you, so I'm going to send somebody else to you by the name of Aaron, and Aaron is waiting on you, and what you'll do is you'll articulate certain things to him so that he can proclaim it to the people. See, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, if you understand how this thing works, you will understand that you're not designed to be the total piece. You're not designed to walk this thing out by yourself. You are designed to connect with a local assembly and a group of believers that allows your anointing and their anointing to connect together, whether they're able to advance the kingdom of God together. But the trick of the enemy is to keep you isolated,
keep you
on an island, and keep you in a place where you think that I don't need nobody else. And then so we'll get all deep. And we start talking about our revelation and what God said to me and, you know, how my prayer closet is. And none of that crap means nothing, because the Bible says the scripture is not open to private interpretation. Right. Darling, I don't care about what God revealed to you, because if you can't apply it, then it's not true to you.
Right.
I need to know what the word of God said. I don't need to know what somebody told you in a prophetic word that was out of season or 800 call that you sent. But now, God is dialoguing. He said, son, you don't have any excuses.
No.
Because I've ordained you to do something.
Yes.
And see, what happens is, the more the struggle, the harder it gets,
my God,
the easier it is, First Lady, for us to forget what God has already said.
My God.
You can find yourself so far deep in something, you start to question your salvation.
This is my
testimony. Some of the stuff I found myself in was like, God, if I'm saved, how in the world is it this bad? If this is you, how in the world is this much hell going on? So the trick of the enemy is to try to get you to forget what God has said. But see, what I love about God is God doesn't ever change his mind.
He does
because
not.
The children of Israel are now, they've been escorted.
Come on.
Somebody say escorted.
Escorted.
They've been escorted out of Egypt. Out of this place of bondage. They've been escorted angelically.
Come on.
To make sure that they're not in this place that's keeping them restricted or bound any longer. And now they're in this wilderness experience.
Yes.
And things just start to happen now. Have you ever felt like in your life that, God, it seems like I'm out of abundance, but crap just keeps happening. The children of Israel, they're out of Egypt, but Egypt is not out of them. And the struggle is real. I know that's something that we say a lot. The struggle is real. I gotta operate by faith. You know, it's not like it used to be. It's not a comfort zone like it used to be. It's not a place of rest any longer. So God now has them in a position where they gotta trust him a little bit more. So they get to this place, and in front of them is the Red Sea. The Red Sea is closed, but see, a closed door is not necessarily always the problem.
That's right.
Because I can get to a place and mark time and be in place. And until God opens the door, I'm okay. Mm-hmm. But see, First Lady, it becomes an issue. When you're marking time and you see your past coming up behind you trying to kill you. Because the Bible says that once Moses escorted them out of the wilderness, they're marking time at the Red Sea. And they're like, what in the world, Moses? Did you bring us out here to die? There's something in front of us that's blocking us. But Pharaoh, the Bible says, sent all his horsemen, all his chariots, all his men, all his government to go and pursue them and to kill them. So what do you do when you're marking time and it's a closed door, but you feel like the enemy is coming up behind you to destroy you? Well, see, now Moses is in between God and the people. So he starts to dialogue and say, God, these your folk, these your people, how in the world did we get here? And God had to remind Moses of what he said about 10 chapters prior to. God had to remind him that I have never changed my mind. See, I need you to understand that just because your trouble changed don't mean God changed his mind. Just because things got bad don't mean God changed his mind. Just because folks start looking at you a certain way does not mean God changed his mind. Because now they're at a place and Moses is before God. And Moses said unto the people, fear not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
These images that you've seen today, ye shall see again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. Now, see, what I love about it is God start then reminding Moses of what he told him in Exodus 4.
That's right.
He said, Moses, lift thou up thy rod.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Lift up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea. Hold on. You're talking about the same rod that I had 10 chapters ago that you was proving to me that it worked when you said throw it down and it turned into a serpent. The same rod that allowed me to believe that it worked then and it's also going to work now. See, for some of you all, your worship has been your rod all the way. And see, the trick of the enemy was to make you put you in a position where you could no longer worship, because he understood the worship was your stone, the worship was your slingshot, the worship is what caused you to be able to transition when there was something in front of you blocking you and you felt like something was coming up behind you trying to kill you. But God never changed his mind. See, some of you all, I know you cried yourself to sleep, but worship is what allows you to wake up with joy. When the nights were before was pain, you wake up joyful because you know the joy of the Lord is your strength. So now they're marking time, and God reminds him. He says, stick out your hand, son.
Uh-huh. Come on.
The thing that I trusted you with, the thing that makes you who you are, the thing that identifies you as being sent by me, stretch it out. And the Bible says the waters immediately. Because Moses didn't try to do something that he can't do. See, the problem with a lot of us in churches, we see somebody doing something. So because we see them do it, we can automatically develop a passion for it and believe that it's our purpose. Ooh. But see, somebody else's passion doesn't equate to my purpose. See, one of the ways to know that you're anointed to do something, let me help you with this, is when people see you, and it looks so easy that they think they can do it.
My God. That's good.
See, when you're anointed to do something, there is not a stretch for it.
Come on.
And you don't have to try to do it.
I like
it. It becomes a part of who you are. Yeah, when you're anointed to do something, it becomes an extension of you. It becomes a part of your flow. It becomes a part of who you are. But see, when you're trying to do something and you're trying to pattern yourself after something, the worst thing you can do is try to be a cheap copy of a great original. The worst thing you can do is try to be a cheap copy of a great original, because an original is only one. There is only one First Lady. There's only one Vincent Leslie. There's only one Ashley. There's only one Susie. The problem is a lot of us try to be something that we're not. And because it's coming from an unauthentic place, the kingdom of God has been impeded, and we're marking time because we're looking at everybody else thinking that everybody's supposed to look the same. But see, nobody's supposed to be the same. That's the reason why we're one body, but there's many members. There's some stuff that I'm not going to ever be able to do.
That's right.
But the trick of the enemy is to make me think that I can do a lot of things good instead of a couple things great. I realize I can't do everything by myself. That's the reason God has sent people to this vision, and you all are picking it up and running with it, because the vision will speak and it shall not lie. God will remind you of what he's put in your hand. Don't allow Satan to uproot it because you had some relationship challenges. Don't allow Satan to uproot it because you may have gone through some legal situation. Don't allow Satan to uproot it because you made some bad financial decisions. Satan, go to hell. You can't stop me.
That's
and
right.
You can't stop what God has put in my hand. God told Moses that what I gave you, stretch it out, son. I'm here to tell you today, it's time for you to stretch it out.
Yes.
Stretch out your praise. Stretch out your worship.
Hallelujah.
Stretch out your ability. Stretch out your gifting. Stretch out the thing that Satan has been trying to keep you bound by.
My God.
Making you feel like you're not qualified to use it because you've gone through something.
My
the
God.
Devil is a liar.
Is a liar.
And see, when you realize that, you start to approach things completely different, and you start to look at folks different.
That's right.
You start to assess people different. Let's go to 1 Samuel. Chapter number 17.
Good word, Bishop.
First Samuel, chapter number 17. First Samuel, chapter number 17. Verse number 38. This is an amazing, amazing text, because this text introduces us to one of the most popular stories in the Bible. It's called David and Goliath. But what's interesting is David was minding his own business. He had been anointed king already, and in him being anointed king, he now is in a position where he's just taking cheese sandwiches to his brothers. And so he was anointed king, but he was still just keeping sheep. And in him doing that, he found himself now in a scenario where he heard about this uncircumcised Philistine. And see, it's amazing, because this challenge had postured itself toward the children of Israel like it was going to destroy them. And David comes on the scene, this little ruddy boy, little musician that played harp, little shepherd boy, little ruddy. He wasn't about nothing. He's kind of like an old Maurice from Huntsville, Alabama or something. That nobody would ever think was going to be nothing. That's a side note. But anyway, now he's in a position where he says, who is this uncircumcised giant that has come to defile the king of our Lord? And now this guy pops on the scene named Saul. See, we all got a Saul. Let me show you who Saul is. Saul is the person ahead of you. The person that you may think is like 3 or 4 steps ahead of you in life.
Yeah, that's all right.
Yeah. They may have a little bit more money than you. Their relationship look like it's all that. They always got a word from the Lord for you. See, that's what the Saul is in your life. And see, Saul, if you're not careful, will start influencing you with his stuff.
Jesus.
And if you're not careful, you will allow Saul's stuff to become your hindrance. Well, listen, let's read this.
My God.
1 Samuel chapter number 17. Verse number 37 says, David said, moreover, the Lord that delivereth me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said unto David, go, and the Lord be with thee. So Saul gave him a word. So listen, let me tell you this. Saul was much bigger than David. Saul had much more armor than David. Saul had even more experience than David. But Saul didn't say, I will fight the giant. He said, the Lord be with you. Isn't it amazing how people would try to give you a prophetic word to go marry somebody, and then they ain't even at the wedding anymore? After you didn't walk out this fake prophecy, they done told you to do something, they ain't even there to see it come to through pass. So Saul,
my God.
I'm preaching. I don't know if you're man of God. Go, and you can do it. You can achieve it. God has commissioned you to usher Christianity into the next dimension. You can do all of that. Go ahead, Saul. Listen to this. Then, as David was leaving, and Saul armed David with his armor, and he put a helmet of brass upon his head.
New year, new people.
Also, he armed him with a coat of mail. Wow. So, Saul told him, go ahead and go. The Lord be with you. But as you go, I got some stuff I want you to carry with you. Saul, in his bag of trips, and said, put this helmet on. Put all this brass on. And I'm going to coat you in this protection that's going to allow you to defeat the enemy. But see, this is what I love about David. I need you to listen to this. This is what David said. And see, this is where you got to get when it comes to transitioning into what God has said concerning you for real. And David girded his sword upon his armor, and he essayed to go, which means he took
all the stuff initially, and then he had to assess some stuff. See, you got to get to a position that, you know what, people have given me ideas.
Don't forget
people
to share.
People have influence. People have, you know, they may have helped me out some. But I got to assess it and see if that stuff really works for me. Because this is what David says. He is safe to go, for he had not proved it. And David said unto Saul, I cannot go with these, for I have not proved them. And David put them off. See, you got to make it up in your mind that you understand that just because somebody else is putting some stuff on you, doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to work for you. Because see, God didn't put that in your hand. God put that in their hands. And see, this is what I love about this story is, if you do the research, you'll find out that if Saul really believed in his armor that much, he would have went and fought the Philistine. But see, people will make you feel like because you don't go the way that they went or they would have gone, that you're out of the will of God. But obviously, Saul did not even trust the stuff that he had, because it didn't give him enough confidence to fight anyway. Isn't it amazing how we surround ourselves around folk that talk a good game, folk that talk like they got it going on, but when you go and you look at them, you see that there's no fruit in their life. Nothing about their life remains. Nothing about their life is consistent. Everything is sporadic. And the only consistency is the inconsistency. So David then begins to talk to Saul and make him understand, I haven't proven that stuff. See, I don't know who it is on this live stream today, but there's some folk that you tried to bring over with you from 2015, and you have not proven them, but you're still letting them hang out. You're still allowing them to influence you. You're still allowing them to dictate your future. But the truth of the matter is, when you start to transition out of bondage for real, you got to leave bound folk in bound places, and you got to step out and start doing something that's completely different. Because this is what David said, and I'm getting ready to close, but David says this, and he took his staff in his hand. Oh my God, isn't it amazing how God would continue to go back to, what have I given you in your hand? What I get that somebody else is trying to put something on you, but what have I given you? What have I allowed to happen to you to birth the purpose and the destiny that God has ordained for you? Stop trying to be everybody else, and you need to get before God and find out, God, what is it that you've given me that's going to allow me to make a difference? And me and my wife was talking this morning, and you know what? I'm okay with legacy, but I don't want nobody talking about my legacy yet. I want somebody talking about my life, because legacy means that I'm gone. No, I want to be here, and I want to make a difference, and I want to advance the kingdom of God at all costs. Yeah, I get that the Bible says a wise man leaves an inheritance for his children's children, and promise you, I'm putting myself in a position to do that, but I'm not ready to have a legacy. I'm ready to have a life. Because when you have a life, then people around you who are dead, people around you that are bound, people around you that have burdens, people that are around you that have yokes, they will see something in you and they will say, what must I do to be saved? It's time out for the church just being quiet and the church being just as bound as the world. I understand you've been delivered from sin, but sin hadn't been delivered from you, because everything you touch is still dying. Everything you do is still failing. It's time out for the church looking just like the world, but it's time for us to be the light of the world. So David now is talking and he says, what is that in thy hand?
Come on. Thank you, Jesus.
And then he starts to go through this resume of the things that's the necessary for him to achieve this desired result.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says this, and he took his staff in his hand and chose him 5 smooth stones out of the brook.
Come on.
And put them in his shepherd's bag. Boy, I feel like preaching now. The thing I love about stones is stones are not created. Stones are formed. Yes, stones literally start off as rocks with rough edges. And as they're laid out over years, the water that flows over the stones,
I love it,
Yes.
Now they've gone from being rocky with rough edges.
Come on, preach it.
To now being smooth stones.
Oh my God.
You see, what I love about God is I know you may be on this call and you may be viewing in and you're saying, well, Bishop, I don't understand what my purpose is yet. Bishop, I don't understand what's in my hand yet. Well, see, that's the reason you've got to stay connected with the Word of God. Jesus. Because the Bible says that the Word of God is designed to wash you, and the Word of God is designed to clean you. See, the more you start delving in His Word, what you'll find is this: the rough edges of your life will start to smooth off.
It will.
The bad relationships will start to smooth off.
It will.
The bad financial decisions will start to smooth off. But it not gonna happen because you attend a financial conference.
Come on.
It's not gonna happen because you tune in to Dr. Phil every day.
Come on.
But it's only gonna happen because the Word of God is there. Huh?
Yes.
And the Word is sharper than any two-edged sword. Huh? The Word is designed to divide soul and spirit.
Huh? Yes.
The Word is the only thing that in the midst of hell,
yes,
the joy of the Lord is your strength.
Yes.
When you embrace who the Word is supposed to be in your life, what you will find is God will start turning stuff around.
Yes,
God will start flipping stuff upside down. God will start making the crooked things straight. But it's all stark because the Word is there. The Word is there to cleanse you. The Word is there to make things smooth for you. Now, David said, those things I put in my bag. And before you know it, now he's before this great enemy, this Goliath, this thing that looks like it's coming not to just destroy him, but to destroy the entire essence of the children of Israel. And when it came time for him to fight, he didn't have to do anything new. He just reached in his bag, grabbed one small stone. The Bible says he put the stone in his slingshot. And with one effort, the stone hit the giant in the middle of his head.
Yes.
Now, I need you to understand how the anointing works.
Yes, kill your Goliath.
This man was completely covered in brass, and it was only one small part that was open. But see, when you're anointed to do something, all God needs is a small opening in order to defeat it. That one stone hit him, caused him to completely be destroyed. David walked up on this giant, stood over him, chopped his head off. And once they saw his head, they knew that the enemy was defeated. But it started because he knew what was in his hand. It is imperative as we walk out this 2016 that we're able to identify exactly what God has given each and every one of us. It's important that we understand that he has given you something special. And he is going to do a fruit inspection on it. And he's coming back to make sure that what he said is coming to pass. It's no longer time for us to remain distracted because we are walking in ignorance. And ignorance, I know we use it as such a negative term and a bad term, but all ignorance is not knowing. It's time out for the church not knowing what we're supposed to be doing. And it's time for us to plug into his word like we've never done it before. It's time for us to attach ourselves and connect ourselves like we've never done it before. And when we do that, we will become a lighthouse that causes others to inquire
fruit
about
inspection,
who is this man named Jesus?
Yes.
Who is this man
that's
changing lives? Who is this man
that
died for you and I? Who is this man that didn't leave you by yourself but left you a comforter in the form of the Holy Ghost to lead you and to guide you and to teach you?
Yes.
When we decide that we're going to embrace that in its totality, our lives will continue to be altered.
Thank you for inviting followers.
Our lives will continue to be changed. Our lives will become evident to those who are not living, but that are only existing.
Mm.
Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for this time that you've given us to dig into your word. Just as you instructed Moses, that you've given him something that was attached to him to assure that he was able to walk out his destiny.
No more distractions.
Father, I thank you right now that there's an anointing being released.
Good morning.
That causes each and every one of us to recognize what's in our hand. Father, encourage them that it's not outside of them, but it's connected to them. And the thing that Satan has been trying to kill is the very thing that you're trying to birth in them.
Yes.
Father, I thank you right now that
there is
focus. Yes. I thank you now, God, that there is a level of tenacity and perseverance and persistence that allows us to walk this out in a godly way to the point where you get complete glory out of our lives. Father, right now we decrease.
Yes, thank you, Jesus.
That you may increase.
Yes.
And that you may have your way in our lives. Father, right now, this same anointing is causing you to be glorified. And it's causing the people of God to be edified. And as usual, Satan, you're terrified and horrified because the truth that we know will make us free. Amen. What is that in thine hand? God bless you all for logging in to our ALM morning worship service. We are excited as God has transitioned us into our own building. And we want to give you an opportunity to play a part in our phase one. In our phase one, we've started our build out already. And God is doing amazing things. So from this place, you're able to be a part of what God is doing here. This ministry is being a blessing to you, and you feel that it'll be a blessing to others. We've conveniently made it where you can donate right from your cell phone where you are right now. 55469, text LIFE, L-I-F-E. And you are able to securely donate from a credit card or a debit card. And you're able to become a partner with us as we continue to advance the kingdom of God at all costs. Phase one is going to allow us to start to do ministry at a greater level. We're so excited. We'll be launching the children's ministry and teen ministry and women's ministry and men's ministry. God is just doing something amazing. So right where you are, 55469, type LIFE.
Thank you, Bernard.
And whatever you need, we're going to pray that God's going to meet your every need. Because the Bible says, give, and it shall be given to you.
Yes.
Good measure. Press down. Shake together and running over. Men are going to give it to our bosoms. Listen, I also want to let you know this, that when you make a decision to keep God first in your life, even from a financial point of view, it obligates him to meet you where you are.
Yes, it does.
If you're believing him for healing, I dare you to sow with that in mind today. If you're believing him for restoration, I dare you to sow with that in mind.
That's right.
If you're believing him for a financial breakthrough, I double dog dare you to sow. Yes. And see, won't he do what his word declares? He said, if you bring it into my house, I'll take care of your house. First things first, ALM family, we love you. We look forward to seeing you next Sunday at 10:30 a.m. at 3940 Buford Highway, Suite B, 110, 10:30 a.m., where it's going down. We're real people with real issues.
Good morning, Harry.
For real answers. God bless you all. And as a believer, remember this, abundant life.
So
belongs to you.
Hallelujah. Thank you all so much for joining us this morning. This has been awesome. Thank you for the hearts. Thank you for sharing. And welcome Miss Mary Hall, Morale's mom. We love you. Hello, Robert and Dolores, Bernard. Thank you for putting up 55469 for us. Good morning, Harry.
Goodbye.
Good morning,
Goodbye.
Kim.
Hi.
Thank you all so much. Y'all have a blessed day. Bye, LaBrenda. Bye, Felicia.
Bye,
love
bye
you.
Felicia. Bye.
Bye, Felicia.
Bye, Felicia.
God bless you all.
Love you too. Thank you, Tangi. Now let's all go to Golden Corral. I love it. Yeah, we hungry. Thank you, Tequila W. Appreciate you.